Welcome to June's Coastal Gardener. Hope your summertime is going well so far. We're on location at the Arboretum here off Oleander Drive in Wilmington, as we often are, looking at plants and problems. And later on, we're going to give you some information about what you should be doing in your lawn. But right now, we're going to take a look at a relatively new planting here at the Arboretum. Now, one of our goals with the Arboretum this year has been to improve what you might call the curb appeal, the area out near the road. We had some places here near the parking lots, weren't all that well done, had kind of gotten overgrown, wasn't much going on with them. So you'll see a whole new area that's been planted here just recently. But starting out at the electronic sign, you may notice if you ride by a really bright, bright pink flower out there, and you say, what in the world is that blooming out there? That is a geranium, believe it or not, or pelargonium, if you want to be more correct. And you don't normally think about that plant being used as a bedding plant in southeastern North Carolina. Most people who do pelargonium or geranium put them in containers because they typically don't do very well as a bedding plant. But there is a selection called Caliente that we're using here, and you may be able to find it. Excellent plant as a bedding plant, very unusual for that geranium. The other good thing about this is you've noticed the bed out there near the sign where they're planted. That bed is full of one of our biggest foes of soil-borne diseases called Phytophthora root rot. And luckily, Caliente is pretty tolerant of that particular disease. If you're trying to grow things like annual vinca, catharanthus, and some of the other things that are really popular, that disease will really create a lot of problems for you. But if you move on across the parking lot a little bit, you'll see this new area. It's a wooded space, kind of, so we're going to be using understory plants. We put a little kind of a walk in the woods stone walkway with some inner plantings of some low growing kind of ground cover stuff to soften it. So it's a place that you can kind of walk in and enjoy, you know, drift along, look at the plants, and then move on to another place in the garden. Some of the things that are out here, as I said, we're having to use things because we have the shade canopy. We have to use things that will tolerate that. But we do have a couple of dogwoods, a very large flowering dogwood. We have a variegated kusa, several selections of redbud, cercus that are out here. You'll see lots of hydrangeas and hostas and caladiums and all kinds of things out here. So interesting colors, textures, a nice little walk in the woods, and improving that curb appeal. One of those things we're trying to do here at the Arboretum. Now, as a gardener, you know, southeastern North Carolina is a pretty darn tough place to grow a lot of plants. And unfortunately for us here, we struggle with a lot of the same problems you have. One thing, if you look at these encore azaleas that are planted here near where I'm standing, they don't look all that great. They're yellow, they look like they have some iron problem, deficiency problems. They're just not growing all that well. And one of the problems we have in our soils here is the pHs are high. And as you well know, these are acid-loving plants, and most of these plants out here in this garden are, and they really struggle with high pHs. One thing we've just recently done the last few days here is we lifted a bunch of these and incorporated a bunch of shredded pine bark to try to help lower that pH. Sulfur applications, doing all those kind of things will help, but like I said, we struggle with a lot of the same problems you have. I mentioned the Phytophthora root rot out there at the sign, the high pH, all of those issues, same kind of things you're dealing with in your own garden. Speaking of an interesting problem, we have a Camperdown elm, a weeping elm, that has something strange going on. Now, Camperdown elm is not a plant we typically use that much in landscapes. This one has been here for a long time at the Arboretum. We moved it several years ago in some of the renovation work, and I was a little concerned about the plant at the time because we didn't get a great root ball and I was afraid we might have killed it. But it survived it and moved on and did very well. Well, come this year, it didn't leaf out like it was supposed to. And you can see even now it's just barely leafing out except for this one little limb that has full-size foliage like it should be. And we started looking at that saying, what in the world is going on with that plant? You know, we haven't done anything around it. We haven't done any root damage. Nothing's been sprayed on it, anything like that. So we started talking to people and discussing this thing, and they said, you know, one of the things that happened this year on a lot of plants that have to have a certain number of chilling hours. You know, we had a very mild winter. A lot of the blueberries, the guys growing fruit commercially, didn't get enough chilling to really get a good crop set. And I think that's what happened with this Camperdown elm. We also had some problems with our Japanese flowering apricots. They finally leafed out, but they are were very slow for leafing out, and the camper down, like as you can see, is even slower. So you may see some things like this going on in your own landscape where things just aren't leafing out, aren't doing the way they should. What this is a lot of plants to break dormancy and grow need a certain number of hours of chilling, and that's usually hours below about 45 degrees Fahrenheit. And a lot of places this year didn't receive the typical amount that we usually get, and you get this kind of thing happening. What do you do about it? Really nothing you can do. Obviously keep the plant healthy and it'll eventually leaf out. Long term probably won't be any damage or any kind of long term problems, but it is something that we may never see again if we don't have a mild winter like we had last year. But just an interesting thing about growing plants here in southeastern North Carolina. Stay with us after the break. We're going to talk to Matt Martin about what you should be doing in the lawn.
What we do to the planet, we do to ourselves. You can help keep America beautiful. Visit kab.org.
Welcome back. You know, June is the perfect time to get your grass really growing. Hot weather, these warm season grasses really love it. And we've got the guy who can tell you all about anything you want to know on a warm season lawn, and that's Matt Martin, our extension associate with the Crop Science Turf Department at NC State University. Matt, thanks for hanging out with us here on the Coastal Gardener. You know, we've got the warm weather really kicking in right now. What should we be doing with the lawns?
Well, now is really the time you can do almost anything with your lawn in terms of fertilizing, weed control, some insects showing up in lawns. So really everything's going on right now. You know, what you should be doing if you haven't fertilized your yard, no matter really what kind of grass you've got, it's time to fertilize. Even if you've got centipede and you fertilize it, it's time to do it. If you've got Bermuda or Zoysia or St. Augustine, you're probably due for a second app of fertilizer right now. If you fertilized a little earlier in the spring, you know, take advantage of the long days that we have in June and July. That's when your grass is really going to grow. Mm-hmm. So now's the time to do it.
And if you're looking for specific recommendations, I get, you know, any of your extension offices will have lawn maintenance calendars that have somewhat recommendations, and you've got all that online with turf files too, don't you?
That's right. You can look on our website is www.turffiles.ncsu.edu. Mm-hmm. And we have a lot of links to maintenance calendars, to different pests you may see in the yard. But yeah, it'll give you a specific calendar for your type of grass. And if you don't know what type of grass it is, bring it into your local extension office and let us ID your grass. A lot of times people have more than one type of grass in their yard.
A lot of mixed centipede St. Augustine out there.
Yeah, and a lot of times you have to make some decisions on which one you really want, mm-hmm. which one you're going to favor in terms of management styles.
Okay. You mentioned pests. What kind of pests are we seeing this time of year?
You know, in terms of weeds, all of the summer weeds are showing up. Insects, we're starting to see chinch bugs show up mm-hmm. in our St. Augustine turf. And we've had a fair amount of mole crickets through the spring in areas. And we have a couple new pests that we see around the area. Well, they're not new, but bill bugs and sugarcane beetles that are some other insect pests that we see. But the main one probably in June we're gonna see would be chinch bugs showing up on St. Augustine.
And that's usually, of course we've talked about chinch bugs before, but that's usually a full sun area of your
yep.
St. Augustine lawn. That's where most people get attacked, isn't it?
Yep, you know, most of the time your St. Augustine may be growing along in the full sun very well, and then it'll start look like it's suffering from drought stress, not getting enough fertilizer, and you'll water, you won't mow any grass, and before you know it, it's turning brown. Mm-hmm. And chinch bugs can happen within a few weeks fairly quickly.
Right.
Your yard will start going from green to yellow to tan.
Right.
Bring us a sample by, you know, about the size of a shoebox. That's a good size to bring by. We'll try to float them out in a bucket of water and see if we can see them. You can do the same thing yourself, but make sure you know what the chinch bugs look like when you start floating them out.
When I've done that with people, a lot of people think chinch bugs are just gigantic bugs that are going to come floating out, and they're really surprised at how tiny they are.
They really are. The juvenile ones are really the size of a large flea.
Yeah.
And but they'll be orange. But yeah, they're not very long. They're really no more than about 2 or 3 millimeters long. So very small insects.
Well, something certainly to keep in mind. We see a lot of damage on these, a lot of areas around Wilmington with St. Augustine in full sun. We see a lot of that.
Yep.
I know you do. You mentioned weeds, and I see you brought some along. So tell us a little bit about what you got here on display.
Well, you know, probably two of the most common weeds in southeastern North Carolina you're going to see in the summer are sedges. Mm-hmm. And we've got a couple different types here. We've got purple nut sedge, and this is a fairly large purple nut sedge plant here. And then we have another type of sedge called globe sedge, which has almost looks like all of the planets, or almost like the solar system of little seed heads here. That's why it's called globe sedge. Mm-hmm. Nut sedge species, I guess there's probably, what, about 10 or so we see common around here. Yellow nut sedge, this one right here, and purple nut sedge, a fairly close relative of that, is they're, what would you say, they're probably the most difficult to kill. Beds and turf.
Yeah, even worse in beds, I'd say. But
and a lot of times the problem, just like the next one, dollarweed, we'll talk about, they kind of commingle themselves. Mm-hmm. You'll have it in a bed, and actually this is where I got this out of, is a bed in my yard, and it's spreading out into the turf.
Yeah.
And so what you have with nut sedge species is they have rhizomes that grow off the bottoms, and then they'll also have tubers. See if we can find a tuber here. Here's a tuber. Mm-hmm. Looks like a little acorn, black or tan acorn, where that plant is growing off of. And you know, as you know, Al, a lot of times guys will spray non-selective herbicides like Roundup in beds on this. Looks like it's dead for about 3 weeks. Then it's right back up and growing. And this is the exact reason why these little tubers here.
All that stored energy.
It's a lot easier to kill a species like globe sedge. It doesn't make the tubers than it is something like yellow or purple nut sedge.
And I guess it's true. Most of the time when I see people with purple nut sedge, they've usually applied something that controls yellow but doesn't control purple very well, and they kind of select out for it.
That's true. And that's the thing with sedge control and turf, is that it can be specific to a certain type of sedge. If you want a sedge control that'll control all of the sedges, something like Image, Sedge Hammer is another one. Probably the best one, and a homeowner can buy this, but it's a little expensive, is one called Certainty.
Yeah.
And it can be applied to all of the warm season grasses.
We've used that here on the Arboretum grounds with very good success based on your recommendations. So Certainty certainly does work.
Keep in mind, if you spray for nut sedge, if you're going to use a backpack sprayer or something like that, be very careful not to overapply. Sedge, products that control sedges will also really hurt your turf.
Yeah.
And a lot of times we see a lot of injury from where people put sedge products out and they injure the turf as a byproduct of putting the sedge product out.
Okay.
The other one would be dollarweed or pennywort, common lawn pennywort. You see it from the beach all the way to, you know, into lawns.
Mm-hmm.
It has a pretty unique seed head that it makes, and lots of these extensive rhizomes.
Yeah, if you live in southeastern North Carolina, probably you've run into dollarweed, and that is I'd say if you're a plant, that's a very successful plant. It'll live in some tough conditions, wet, relatively dry, just about anywhere if it gets a toehold.
And just like with the nut sedges, because of these extensive rhizomes that it has, it's easy to kill parts of the plant, but it's really difficult to kill all parts of the plant. And this one will have tubers as well, small little, almost like nutlets like the nut sedge will.
So what do you recommend in your home lawn if you're going to try to control dollarweed?
Well, one thing to recommend and to tell people with both of these is that you're never going to completely eradicate them.
Yeah.
You can manage them, and when you see them, spray them, and you'll have good success. If you let them fully come back and then spray them, they're hard to control. But as you see little pieces come up, if you spray them, they're pretty, you know, not too bad to control. You know, one of the easiest ones for homeowners to use is a combination of 2,4-D and MCPP and dicamba called a three-way herbicide. Mm-hmm. That works really well on dollarweed. There's one called Speed Zone Southern that they can buy that's really good for this. And there's others, but for a homeowner, that's probably one of the easier ones. If you'll follow the label directions, you really won't injure your turf very bad with those herbicides.
Even the Centipede St. Augustine?
Yeah, you know, I think if you follow the label directions and you really don't really try to soak the weed when you spray it, that's I think that's one of the big problems we run into is people think they need to absolutely soak it. You really just need to wand across it, get one little application of your herbicide, and that'll take care of it.
Okay. Any other pests or anything else we need to think about here in June on our warm season grasses?
Well, you know, if you've seen grubs in the past, it's a good time to do some grub control, but we don't see a predominant amount of grubs like you might in the Piedmont or the western part of the state. Mm-hmm. But if you've seen grubs in the past, now's a good time to do preventative grub control. Mole crickets will be coming out in the next few months again, so a good time to do fire ant mole cricket treatments. Okay. So great time to work in your yard right now.
Yeah, the lawns are certainly looking good if they're the ones except the ones that have the ground pearls and the nematodes and
yeah.
All the things that we do have a lot of problems in our lawns here in southeastern North Carolina. Well, Matt, great bunch of information there. Appreciate your advice on getting some of these really tough to control weeds out and getting that grass looking good. Stay with us. We'll be back in a moment. Yeah.
What we do to the planet, we do to ourselves. You can help keep America beautiful. Visit KAB.org.
Welcome back to the Coastal Gardening. You know, we're always talking about pest problems here on the show, and we've got a new one for you, one that you may have run into on your wisteria and some of your other legumes. And that's one we call kudzu bug. Now this is a relatively new pest. It was introduced in Atlanta somehow or another, not quite sure, from Japan back in 2009. And unfortunately they've made their way through and we've had them this year for the first time. This is a little shield-shaped bug. It's a stink bug in that group of insects and it does emit that foul smell if you mess with them. A kind of an olive green with some speckles on it. Pretty distinctive critter if you have them. As you can see on the wisteria here at the Arboretum, they're congregated on the stems. They don't chew holes in the foliage. They actually insert their mouth parts into the stems and drink the sugar solution out, so it weakens the plant. Now, is that going to create a big problem for a wisteria? Probably not if it's healthy. This plant's aggressive enough that it'll tolerate the damage. The concern really for kudzu bug is more in soybeans and peanuts, which are pretty big crops here in North Carolina. And since it is a relatively new pest, we don't really have a lot of information about what to do about them or how to control them. That we do know that the typical insecticides, the Carbaryl 7, things like that, bifenthrin, will control them, the ones you contact with, but there's so many of them at times it's almost a exercise in futility trying to control them with contact insecticides. What you'll see also is they're attracted to light colored surfaces, almost like the Asian lady beetles that do this in the fall. If you have white or yellow siding on your house, this is a bug that'll just congregate on that side of the house and just create problems for you, more of a nuisance, not doing any serious damage to your plants probably, but does create a serious nuisance. So what are we going to do about it? Well, we got a lot to learn about how to control them, so really don't have great recommendations as yet. We do know that they like the legumes, so the wisterias and some of the others, the beans and things like that, are the ones they're going to attack. You may see them congregating and resting on other plants, crepe myrtles, things like that. They don't feed on those, so you really don't have to worry about treating there. But if you do have beans and things like peas in your vegetable garden and they attack, it probably is worth controlling them. On a wisteria, probably not serious enough pest there to really make much difference. So I guess the bottom line is for kudzu bug, we don't know that much just yet. There's a lot of research going on in South and North Carolina right now, mostly worried about soybeans. But we'll have some new information hopefully before the summer is over, and we'll be able to give you some better recommendations. But you probably will see them in the fall congregating on the sides of your house and maybe working their way in. Probably time to get the vacuum cleaner out when that happens. Before we close the show out, let's go over and talk to Leslie Wilson about some opportunities in 4-H. We're joined now by Leslie Wilson, who is the person in charge of our youth programming here at Cooperative Extension in the Arboretum. Of course, that's 4-H. And Leslie, welcome to the show. I'm glad you're here.
Thank you.
You know, when people think about 4-H, most of the time they think about animals and traditional agriculture, but 4-H has a lot to offer besides that, doesn't it?
We really do. A lot of the things that we focus on in 4-H are leadership, citizenship, science and technology, and healthy living. So we're really a lot broader of a program than people traditionally think that we are.
Well, and I guess in an urban environment like we are here in New Hanover County, that's pretty important because obviously we don't have a lot of traditional agriculture. So speaking of opportunities in 4-H, we're coming into summertime, the hot weather, and tell us a little bit about what opportunities you have during the summer this year.
We have a lot of camps that we hold during the day here at the Arboretum for kids 5 years old all the way up to 18. And we group them into what we call Clover Buds, who are 5 to 8 year old youth. We have 3 camps for them this summer. We have some opportunities for 9 to 12 year olds, and then we have a few camps for teenagers as well.
What are the most popular ones that you have every year?
One of our big camps this summer is going to be a gardening camp that we're holding, actually more like a class, on Monday mornings from 9:30 to 11:30. Kids can come here to the Arboretum, learn how to grow things, and also learn about, you know, what different habitats are important, how we can draw insects and reptiles and different things to our gardens.
Okay. I guess that's appropriate here on the coastal garden. Mm-hmm. Now, I know you've got some others that probably might be a little more interesting to the average adolescent out there. What are the?
We do. We actually have a couple of surf camps planned. We'll be surfing in Topsail Beach with Odyssey surf instructors, and that's always really a popular one as well. We also have some fun things for the Clover Buds, the 5 to 8 year olds. We have a camp called Mad Scientists, where we learn about bubbles and water, and we do some really neat experiments with those.
So tell the viewers how they kind of when they start and how they sign up right now.
Our first camps start on June 11th, and they run through mid-August. Okay. And to sign up for those, there's registration forms here at the Arboretum. They can also go onto our website and download the forms.
Okay. And we can put the number up, I guess, on the screen here. But, of course, the main number here is 798-7660 if you want to talk to. And you need to ask for Leslie. Well, Leslie, we appreciate you joining us here on the Coastal Garden and talking a little bit about 4-H, our very important youth component of Cooperative Extension. So thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
That wraps up the June show, so we'll look forward to seeing you guys in July.